Welcome, everybody, to this fourth and final of this semester installment in the Center for Historical Research Lecture Series. I'm Sarah Butler. I'm the director for the Center for Historical Research at Ohio State. For those who don't know a lot about the center, it is run out of the history department at the Ohio State University, and it's an interdisciplinary foundation dedicated to providing a stimulating intellectual environment for the discussion of important historical issues from across the world. We are currently in the second year of our program. It's a two-year program entitled Crisis, Uncertainty, and History, Trajectories and Experiences of Accelerated Change. And today, as I said, we are going to have our fourth and final talk of the semester. But I do want to alert you as well to the fact that Adam Tooze of Columbia University, author of Crashed, How a Decade of Financial Crises Changed the World, is going to be coming to speak to us virtually in January, January 13th. So please feel free to put that on your calendars. I'm now going to turn things over to Dr. Nicholas Breifogel, who is Associate Professor of History here at the department, but also Director of the Goldberg Center. He is going to be introducing our speaker for today. Thank you.
Thanks, Sarah. It is a great pleasure to be able to welcome Serhy Yekelchyk to join us today. Born and educated in Ukraine when it was still part of the Soviet Union, Serhy Yekelchyk received his Ph.D. from the University of Alberta. He's the author of seven books on modern Ukrainian history, Stalinism, and Russo-Ukrainian relations. His monograph entitled Stalin Citizens, Everyday Politics in the Wake of Total War from Oxford in 2014, was the recipient of the Best Book Award from the American Association for Ukrainian Studies, and its Ukrainian translation in 2019 received a special diploma of the Lviv Book Forum. Yekelchyk's most recent publication is the second, much expanded edition of his popular book about the Euromaidan Revolution and the Russian aggression in Ukraine, entitled Ukraine, What Everyone Needs to Know, from Oxford in 2020. And I would, just as a plug, he's not paying me to say this, but it's a marvelous book, and I recommend it to everybody as an intro. I have given it to just about every one of my relatives whenever they ask me, what's going on in Ukraine? So I say, read this. Serhy is currently working on a history of the Ukrainian Revolution in 1917 to 1920, and a professor of history and Slavic studies at the University of Victoria. Yekelchyk is current president of the Canadian Association for Ukrainian Studies, and we're just delighted to have him with us today. Before we begin, we'd like to acknowledge that the land that the Ohio State University occupies is the ancestral and contemporary territory of the Shawnee, Potawatomi, Delaware, Miami, Peoria, Seneca, Wyandot, Ojibwe, and Cherokee peoples. Specifically, the university resides on land ceded in the 1795 Treaty of Greenville and the forced removal of tribes through the Indian Removal Act of 1830. We want to honor the resiliency of these tribal nations and recognize the historical context that have and continue to affect the indigenous peoples of this land. With that introduction, I'll turn the microphone over to Serhy Yekelchyk, who will enlighten us on Ukraine. So, Serhy.
Thank you very much, Nick. Thank you very much, Sarah. Thanks to all of you who came to this talk today. I'm joining you from a beautiful sunny day in Victoria, British Columbia, on an island off the Pacific coast of Canada, but equally close to Seattle. And this visit, which at some point was planned as an actual campus visit, is now virtual, and the world in which we live is also to a significant degree influenced by that virtuality of knowledge and presence. As you can see, my background picture behind me is actually a view of the city of Kyiv, the Ukrainian capital. And this is where my heart is. I'm from the city and my parents are in this city right now, and plenty of friends and relatives. There are some colleagues who are fighting at the front lines, even full professors actually, and some very good specialists. And the dean of history at the university from which I graduated as an undergraduate, the dean took a year off, or perhaps more than a year now, to join the army as a first lieutenant. So that was quite a change. In other words, not just in terms of geopolitics and talking about Ukrainian history, but also about the experience of being connected in so many ways. And getting from my Facebook feed and other social media, the news before they hit the screen of major television and other companies. And this connectedness, of course, is yet another reason for us to reflect on the role of historian in the modern world and on how our explanations obscure or perhaps clarify the complex interaction of historical actors that produces the results that seem so obvious and predetermined to some media commentators. I'm sure many of you have had this experience with the media when they really want simple answers within 1 minute, maximum 3 minutes. And the struggle which goes into kind of translating the complexity into a few very short sentences, or even having to object to the anchor, which did happen to me on Chinese state-run television, the China Global. So that's basically the world in which suddenly colleagues in my field find ourselves in significant demand in trying to elaborate on the historical reasons for that war. And every time I'm asked to talk about the historical background, I need to insert a reservation right away from the very beginning. And that is that it is Mr. Putin's important line that it's all about history. And he prefers to see it as a restoration of historical justice, returning Ukraine to what it should really be like, part of Russia, historically. But my argument today is going to be that not only the history is more complex and open to a variety of interpretations, some of them, in fact, fairly frustrating for Mr. Putin's imperial project, but also it is the uses of history and memory in the present that explain to a significant degree the nature of the war. So not the history itself, but the way it is remembered in Ukraine and in Russia serve as an important reminder to us that battles about history are actually battles about politics in the present. And that is going to be my second point and perhaps a more important argument of this talk. But let me start with history. I see that the audience here includes a number of colleagues who are very knowledgeable about what I'm going to talk about. So I'm going to do some shortcuts as well. So in July 2021, the Russian President Vladimir Putin published a historical piece on historical unity of Ukrainians and Russians. It is sort of strange when you see a major politician publish historical treatises. It does happen in Europe still, in some parts of Europe, but also that's a signal very often to us that something isn't right in that part of Europe, because those historical treatises by politicians come dangerously close to a declaration of intent to rewrite history with violence, and perhaps to quote unquote correct the historical wrongs by starting a war or two. So basically, when a politician writes and publishes a history treatise, that's your warning sign. And it was understood precisely this way in the field and by many people in Ukraine too. When the president, or really a dictator of the neighboring very large country, nuclear power, and the former imperial master of Ukraine, suddenly gets obsessed with Ukrainian history and starts arguing that Ukrainian history is really part of the Russian history. It's not just about history at all, but it is actually about the present day Russia and Ukraine. So what does Mr. Putin find frustrating? In this article, he actually makes an important point which connects it right away to his present day strategic concerns and his picture of the world as well. He starts basically by saying that Ukrainians and Russians are part of the same people. They're basically the same. But it was the West which over centuries tried over and over again to divide them, to create Ukraine as an artificial entity. And the West historically was represented by Poland, by Germany, by the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And of course, now it is the European Union and the United States, and Canada also plays a minor role there. So the West has changed, but the intent stayed the same. And of course, the explanation for that strange vision is the fact that the West, according to Mr. Putin, had always wanted to destroy Russia and tried repeatedly over centuries to destroy Russia. Now, the reality of historical relationship between Russia and Ukraine is complex in that we now do history in a different way. Let's say 100 years ago, or perhaps 150 years ago, it would have been very easy to argue that Ukraine has always indeed been part of Russia because it was all about political history. And indeed, the royal dynasty, the succession, points us to the fact that from Kiev, the center of power moved east and north and eventually settled in Moscow. So there is a continuity in rulers, no matter how sketchy it is in certain places. And there is a continuity of religion as well, Orthodox Christianity, Eastern Christianity. So if we were to think about history in this way, and also in terms of great men and sometimes women on history, it would have been very easy to say that, yes, well, the Ukrainians are primarily peasants. So they don't as such constitute a nation, defined politically, and perhaps in this respect, even in religious criteria, would point us to Moscow. But of course, ever since social history arrived, and even before that, the analysis becomes different. It becomes a question of whether there is a continuity of everyday life and the dialects spoken in the areas that once constituted the heart of the medieval confederation of Kiev and Rus. And if we go this way, there would be some interesting debates in the 19th century about continuity, with the Russian Empire already realizing that there is danger there, really, keeping Kyiv as part of Russian history. But today, it's very pronounced, in fact, that there is a crisis of Russian historical imagination because this early and most glorious page of Russian history, now in the age of social history and people's sovereignty and universal franchise, means that it is actually Ukrainian. And the problem there is that you get what the graves of legendary Russian knights, Ilya Muromets, a well-known and much beloved character of Russian historical epic poetry, was actually a real person who is buried in Kiev. You could go before the war, before Mr. Putin's war, you could go and look at his body, preserved actually as a mummy, I think. So the first chronicle writer, the first known doctor, the first painter and architect we know by name in Russian history are all there. And of course, it also influenced the Russian Empire in a way that it had to always connect its past to Kiev. And that had implications for the Russian Empire's encounter with the Ukrainian national movement starting in the 19th century. So if you looked at most recent news from the Russian archaeological profession, you've probably noticed that in recent decades, Russian archaeologists have been doing significant work in the Russian northwest, in Ladoga and near Novgorod. And that attention there is not, of course, accidental. This is precisely because of the loss, or kind of symbolic loss of Kiev, that a page of Russian medieval history needs to be uncovered in the Russian Northwest, which would then emerge as the original location of the Rus state, as opposed to Kiev. So that is already an important tension there. But there is also the fact that the Ukrainians, as they developed under the influence of the evil West, also Mr. Putin believes, have acquired certain features that really separated them from Russia culturally and in terms of political imagination as well. It is a little known fact that when the two groups met again at Pereyaslav in 1654 to negotiate and sign the Union Treaty, which we don't quite know whether it was a union or military alliance, how to interpret the terminology used there. But when they did meet, the ambassadors arrived, the boyars arrived from Moscow, but the Cossack officers in Ukraine on the ground actually asked them to make an oath to protect the rights and freedoms of the Cossack social group. That inaugurated an awkward moment in what was for a long time considered the most glorious page of Russo-Ukrainian relations. The Muscovite envoys refused to swear an oath on behalf of the Tsar, arguing that the Tsar is really a despotic ruler who cannot guarantee anything to his subjects, and he would never make declarations like that. Of course, the Ukrainians brought this concept from the Polish encounter, with the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. So the very concept of a kind of early modern social contract of sorts, that the ruler guarantees the observance of rights of certain social categories, was to them already an important part of their political life. So as a historian, sometimes I wish I could be a fly on the wall at that particular moment to hear what arguments were used by both sides as they fought each other over this issue of the Tsar swearing an oath, to keep the rights and privileges of his new subjects or not. In the end, the Cossack officers gave in, and allowed basically the oath ceremony to proceed throughout Ukraine without any reciprocating gestures. And in the long run, of course, 1654 became seen as the moment of reunification of Ukraine with Russia. And that's precisely the language the Soviet authorities used as well. And I happened to be involved early on in research on just how that terminology developed. And it turned out that in 1948, the Great Soviet Encyclopedia commissioned a prominent Ukrainian historian of the Cossack period to write about Pereyaslav. And that person, who was trained before the revolution, after the revolution, he was a student of the prominent Ukrainian national, or perhaps nationalist in the Russian rendition, historian Mykhailo Hrushevsky. So he was trained under very, very different systems, educational and also ideological ones. But he was the one who, in his article for the Great Soviet Encyclopedia, brought back the familiar tsarist term of reunification. Because, of course, the way it is used in Russian and Ukrainian, it's only the two parts of the same nation or group previously existing that can be reunited, as opposed to an act of union, for instance, right, in Scottish history. And so, and that from that actually developed an argument about Stalin's historical imagination, which constituted a significant part of my first book in English. And that is, of course, that it was not created from scratch, but rather it was a restoration of a familiar tsarist concept of a three components of the great Russian nation, Ukrainians and Belarusians being the other two components. In tsarist times, the term plemya or tribe would be used for them, not in Soviet times. But nevertheless, that notion of brotherhood, of fraternity of these people really allowed to rehabilitate the notion which never truly, really disappeared. Because It was only a short period in the 1920s and maybe very early 1930s when the Soviet policies guaranteed affirmative action programs to the people previously colonized and disadvantaged in the Russian Empire. So the imperial concepts actually had continuity across the 1917 divide, and they were restored in a way under Stalin, and that line continued into the present, all the way into the present. So what then perspective does it give us on Mr. Putin's historical article? Very interesting one. As many of you know, Putin is quite uneasy about the Russian Revolution. The 100th anniversary of the Russian Revolution in 1917 did not receive within the Russian Federation any significant coverage you would expect. It was a moment of embarrassing, almost silence, not the complete silence, of course, there were scholarly events and such. But at a state level, one can think of Mr. Putin's opening the monument to the victims of the Great Terror in 2017, given a talk, a half an hour speech really, in which Stalin's name is not mentioned once. So he talks about the Great Terror without Stalin, but it is done, the monument is opened on the 100th anniversary of the revolution. And then it is the Bolsheviks, turns out, who committed the Great Terror. And the Bolsheviks also did a number of other things, such as creating Ukraine. So that point comes very clearly in a number of Mr. Putin's public appearances and the texts published under his name. And the speeches, some of them off the cuff speeches, it so seems. So it's a point that is important to him. How to reconcile it, however, with this Westerners constantly trying to break Ukraine from Russia? Well, that's easy. Marxists are Westerners. That fits in beautifully. They are the followers of Karl Marx. They take their ideas from Europe. They destroyed the Russian Empire, which of course was always the intention of the West. And so Mr. Putin repeats a number of times, sometimes given slightly different dates about when it happened, but he claims that it was the Bolsheviks who created, or Lenin and others, he says, God knows why, created Ukraine in the 1920s. Or in another speech, he said in 1920. So, and he's quite a bit annoyed with the fact that they used, he says, parts of historical Russia to create artificially the Ukrainian nation. Well, so here then, we need to dig deeper into history to see what's going on there. So he seems to suggest that the Ukrainian nation did not exist before 1920 or the 1920s until Lenin showed up on scene and created it. Well, of course, the problem is that in the late 17th century and going into the 18th century, the monks and other intellectuals from Kiev started migrating into the imperial capitals of Russia and brought with them a historical explanation which clearly connected the Russian Tsars to the past of Kievan Rus. Innocenti Gisel's synopsis, published in the late 17th century, really became perhaps one of the first or the first Russian history textbook, written by a Ukrainian monk who wanted to argue that there is a prominent place for Ukrainians in the Russian now empire because the Russian empire itself developed from Kievan Rus. And so this particular concept actually develops quite widely. And it is ironically then actually initiated by Ukrainian intellectuals themselves. And a very similar process is taking place as the Cossack officers are incorporated in the Russian hierarchy when the Cossack autonomous structures are disappearing going into the second part of the 18th century. Everybody is trying to claim origins of descending from some Cossack officer. The famous or perhaps infamous case is that of Nikolai Gogol, And the real family name, of course, being the Yanovskis, but the Gogol is the Cossack name. And so they managed, perhaps by way of small bribes here and there, to persuade the authorities that they have the nobility rights. It's an important thing for Gogol to receive his education in his day. Education, of course, is reserved for noble men, right? And so again, they're helping actually based on their own interest as a social group to incorporate the developments in the Ukrainian lands into the Russian Empire. And then there is a name. The name which can be very misleading, but very convenient for imperial purposes. And of course, Rus was never Kievan Rus. That's the term invented by later historians, but it was nevertheless the Rus land. The name itself is, of course, Scandinavian, no matter how many times Soviet historians tried to deny it over and over again. But my point is not that. My point is that, of course, the people on the ground were called Rusins, which, interestingly enough, in subsequent Russian literature became modified into Rusichi. And Rusichi is now an important term in kind of Russian nationalistic version of history. People of Rus. But historically, it seems they were called Rusins. And even in the 20th century, perhaps even today, there are some people living in the mountains near the border between Ukraine and Poland, Ukraine and Slovakia, who in fact call themselves that very same name, Rusins. So the people of Rus. But of course, that was the Rus, the medieval Rus, not the modern Russia. But for so many colleagues of mine, it's so much easier when writing a textbook to subsume this complexity under the notion of Russian history extending all the way from the arrival of Slavs into the area of the Dnipro River in allegedly the 5th century and to the present. Because the names are then getting redefined in various ways. In the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which ends up holding part of the historical Ukrainian lands, which are now Ukraine, the Rusins become Ruthenians from a Latinized form, which is established by Habsburg emperors as the accepted name. But going into the age of modern nationalism, it becomes important with the development of Ukrainian national consciousness, with realization that the peasants speak similar dialects and wear similar embroidered shirts across the border between the Russian and Austro-Hungarian Empire. It becomes important then to find a name which would replace that misleading one. And the fact that there was a continuity across the border is confirmed by an authority no less than Tsar Nicholas II when he goes in 1915 on his trip into Galicia, into the occupied part of Galicia. And once he crosses the border, his, as you know, his diaries and letters are usually not very informative, mostly about hunting crows and things like that, something really. But that's the moment when he says, oh, it looks like Little Russia, really, on this side. So the Tsar himself acknowledges there is an ethnographic continuity across the border. But of course, for him, it is Little Russia, originally a religious term, which became an official imperial term on the Russian side. And on the Austrian side, the term is Ruthenian. But in the 1890s, the age of modern nationalism, that name gets changed to Ukrainian. And that the process, which takes some time to complete. And it is around the same time that the idea of Ukrainian independence is first expressed. Not expressed by the Austrian general staff, as would be subsequently claimed, but actually by Ukrainian socialists. So the first person to advance in modern times the notion of the Ukrainian peasants constitute the majority on these territories, ethnographic Ukrainian territories, or ethnolinguistic Ukrainian territories, are entitled to to self-rule is actually a Galician socialist, Julian Baczynski. So he's a European social democrat who is perhaps a bit to the left, but it doesn't come from radical right wing at all. It comes from the opposite angle, actually. And then, as the 20th century begins, there are political thinkers on all sides advising the idea of Ukrainian independence. However, this notion is not prevalent in Ukrainian political thought at all. And the situation persists in which the majority of the population in the Russian Empire does not consider themselves Ukrainian. They just don't know what it is. There's a beautiful memoir of one Ukrainian activist who served in the Crimea, actually, in 1917, the moment when the Russian army undergoes a very significant transformation, the moment when, after the revolution, after the collapse of the monarchy, national units are created in the Russian army. And so he organizes a rally in his regiment and then begins by asking, who considers themselves little Russians? Please raise your hands. So some one third of the audience raises the hand. And then who considers themselves ho-holes is another kind of slightly dismissive term for Ukrainians. Another third, and how about Ukrainians? Tiny minority. But then he says, now all three groups, could you please raise your hands together? And then it turns out that there is an entire sea of Ukrainian soldiers serving there who are eager to join the Ukrainian army. And that, of course, brings us to a very important episode for the understanding of what is going to happen. In the Russian Empire, the concept very close to the heart of Mr. Putin was enforced officially. The empire denied the existence of the Ukrainian ethnic group. Not only denied it, but it denied the right for Ukrainian culture to function, and also denied that there existed a separate Little Russian culture. So the concept was essentially that if you educate a Little Russian, that person would become a Great Russian, or Russian properly speaking. For that purpose, the empire issued two pieces of legislation, or rather a circular letter in the first instance, in 1863 and in 1876, which applied consecutively, eliminated the possibility of publishing in the Ukrainian language. So that indicates to us that not only there was a rejection of Ukrainians' existence, but also there was actually a realization that their existence would threaten some deeper structures of Russian history and some deeper structures of the Russian Empire as well. So historians of nationalism in the Russian Empire would argue that it was not, in fact, a modernizing version of Russian nationalism which forced Ukrainians to assimilate. No, there was no such program in the 19th century. And in part because the Russian Empire also didn't really educate its own Russian peasants, ethnic Russian peasants, about being Russian. But it wanted to prevent the Ukrainian peasants from realizing that they were different. It was blocking the Ukrainian national movement rather than actually assimilating Ukrainians. That was part of the project. Now, that is of importance in many ways, but also of importance is the fact that the Russian Empire didn't have the control over all the ethno-linguistic Ukrainian territories. And so in the Austrian Empire, going into the 1890s, several important things happen. One is, of course, the transition to the new name, Ukrainians. Interestingly enough, the name Ukraine appears historically very early. The first mentions that survived are from the 12th century, apparently used widely in the late medieval period, but for the territory, not the people. So it took all that time for the term Ukrainians to actually develop in the late 19th century. And so, because the Russian Empire wanted to keep the Ukrainian peasants ignorant about the world of modern nationalism, that project was undermined by the fact that the Austro-Hungarian Empire did not do the same. The Austro-Hungarian Empire was, of course, as you know, a very different entity which recognized at least 12 major nationalities and accommodated them in terms of schooling. And even the regiments of an imperial army were organized by the regional principal, and the Austrian officers posted to a regiment were expected to start learning the regimental language right away, in addition to German as a language of command. So under the circumstances then, it was fairly difficult for the Russian Empire to keep a lid on Ukrainian identity, if that Ukrainian identity was in fact developing in the neighboring empire under the conditions much more favorable. There are some complexities that I wouldn't go into right now, because the very notion of what is modern Ukrainian literary language was being debated and solved beginning in the 1860s due to the talent of one particular Ukrainian writer born as serf, Taras Shevchenko, who is now a national icon of Ukrainians, monuments to him all around the place, including in Canada and in Washington, D.C. But once the issue of the language was sorted out, turned out that Ukrainians were acquiring political experience in the Austro-Hungarian Empire as well. So in a way, Putin is right. So they don't get a chance in the Russian Empire to get education to publish in Ukrainian or participate in politics, but they do get that chance in Europe. So the Austro-Hungarian Empire produces several generations of Ukrainian politicians, usually peasant sons who received law degrees or who were priests. And of course, the priests in the Ukrainian Catholic Church, previously known as Union Church, are married, which makes all the difference, because priestly families, the people, children educated, there are not enough positions, not enough parishes for everybody, and therefore they go into teaching profession, they become statisticians, they become lawyers, they actually produce the leadership stratum for the Ukrainian movement. Also, in the Austro-Hungarian Empire, they manage to reach out to the population because, again, of an education. They create a number of prosvita societies in the countryside. Prosvita means enlightenment. And it's one of those kind of populist movements in late 19th century Europe where intellectuals go to the people, very much the same way as happens in the Russian Empire, except here the main emphasis is on working with the peasants to educate them as members of an ethnic nation. And so, then there is a stream of contraband literature coming from the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which the Russian Empire cannot control, really, just running out of capacity. And there is a moment coming soon, the moment is going to happen with World War I, when the masses of Ukrainians on the Russian side and on the Austrian side are going to come into contact on the front lines, and especially when they become POWs. And then they discover that on the other side, well, they're, you know, Ukrainian officers all of a sudden. And there's a fascinating story of Olena Stepaniev, who was one of volunteer women joining the Ukrainian Legion on the Austro-Hungarian side. She was taken prisoner in 1915. And the moment she was taken prisoner, she didn't speak Russian, actually. But it turned out that the majority of officers she found on the Russian side were also Ukrainian. So they could understand each other by speaking in Ukrainian. And she actually tells us that as she was being transferred from the location near the front line to a POW camp for officers, because she was an officer cadet in addition to being a woman, so she was put in an officer's camp, she was accompanied by a lieutenant who was also Ukrainian, from the Russian Ukraine. And she says, almost all this trip was consumed by our debate about Ukrainian politics, about whether Ukraine would have to be in a federation with Russia and other free nations after monarchy collapses, or whether Ukraine would have to be independent. And that basically gives you a stunning perspective on what World War I meant for Ukrainians, right? And of course, there was a concerted effort on the part of Central Powers to actually bring this message to POWs, to the Russian POWs who were in fact Ukrainian. And so then it's really not Lenin at all here, but in fact, the logic of national movements coming to the center stage in the age of imperial collapse, which is marked by World War I. So that is the moment. If we really wanted to pinpoint the development of a modern Ukrainian nation, that would be the one. And of course, before Mr. Putin, you know, says, right, that confirms my point. There was no modern Ukrainian nation until whatever, 1914 or 1917. And at that point, I would, of course, have to argue, but there was no modern Russian nation either. And perhaps there is still no modern Russian nation, which understands itself as, you know, democratic modern nation, as opposed to being an heir to an empire, which is having difficulty replacing this post-imperial identity with something more meaningful for people and civil society. So there is nothing wrong with the fact that the modern Ukrainian nation is formed in the 20th century. It would have been good for the modern Russian nation to be formed around the same time, but that is not what happened. Well, Lenin was actually around, and actually just before the start of World War I, Lenin apparently in Krakow, not yet Polish, still Austrian, in Galicia, just across the border from all these developments, very close to where Olena Stepaniev has been engaging in conversation with a Russian lieutenant about Ukrainian independence and autonomy. Lenin is on the Polish side, and he is discovering, due to his Polish experience, the significance of the national question of ethnic nationalism. He reportedly attends a Ukrainian party in Krakow, marking one of the anniversaries of Taras Shevchenko, the national bard, the poet. Soviet painters were producing painting on the topic of Lenin at the event dedicated to Taras Shevchenko. Of course, we don't quite know what Lenin meant by going there. He realized definitely, and that comes through very clearly in his writings, that the Russian imperial prohibition to celebrate 100th anniversary of Taras Shevchenko is the moment when you can define the Russian Empire as the prison of people. And that's what it does. He writes a speech for one of the Duma deputies, Grigory Petrovsky, himself from Ukraine, to be given there. The speech is never delivered, but it actually becomes part of the Bolshevik program, the Bolshevik attention to the nationalities issue. So Lenin is not inventing the Ukrainian nation. He is discovering the power of nationalism. But that particular realization really comes to him in 1919. And that's because when the Russian monarchy collapses in 1917, I here have to go back to that particular memoir about asking the soldiers whether they're Ukrainians, little Russians, or ho-hos. Why would all of them be so interested? Why there would be such an impressive moment of mobilization? In Kyiv, Ukraine, at the same time, March 1917, there is an enormous manifestation, the rally of Ukrainians, and local commentators say, well, I never realized there were so many Ukrainians in this city. It's a Russian imperial city and such, administrative center. In the army, more than a million soldiers in the Russian imperial army would like to join the Ukrainian regiments and divisions being organized. So this enormous moment of mobilization comes from somewhere. And of course, this is the point my colleagues in Ukraine find kind of sometimes difficult to deal with. And the point is, of course, very simple, that the mobilization for Ukrainian, for a modern Ukrainian nation benefited from the moment of mobilizing against the war. That the soldiers wanted to leave the front lines. They wanted to leave the trenches, to go for reorganization into some rear territories, ideally to be transferred to Ukraine for reorganization. And that was one big idea for them, getting out of the trenches. And the second one, for peasant soldiers, the upcoming distribution of land, as many of you know, the peasants in the Russian Empire never gave up on the idea of redistributing the land, which will have to happen at some point, that the crown lands and the lands of and the large farms are redistributed and the land is going to be theirs. So they want to be close to the land there in Ukraine in order not to be cheated out of the chance. That's an impressive moment. But of course, the Ukrainian government in 1917 cannot take advantage of it for a variety of reasons, because it soon needs to mobilize a different army. It actually has to completely abandon the Ukrainianized regiments and divisions of the former Russian army, actually dissolve them because they are useless, and start forming a new army from the volunteers with a developed Ukrainian identity and loyalty. And so the famous episode, which comes up in narratives of Ukrainian history, is the sacrifice of students, high school students and university students from Kyiv University at the railway station of Krute in January 1918, where they try to delay the arrival of the Bolshevik troops, the Red Guards, essentially, in fact, sent straight from Russia, and then mobilizing people in Kharkiv, in the first city near the border, the one which is now seeing lots of shelling. And so somehow there are no people there because it has to be done by the volunteers. And so the volunteers die there. Many of these young students are captured and executed by the Bolsheviks, but they delay the Bolshevik advance and they become the martyrs and heroes of Ukrainian history. Why is this episode also important? Well, because of the notion of national tragedy and sacrifice. When the Ukrainian government comes back a few months later, they organize a solemn ceremony for the burial of those heroes. And the head of the Ukrainian government, the de facto speaker of the parliament, Professor Hrushevsky, the historian, gives a very important speech. He says that all these difficult knots were now untangled, broken, cut by blood. So once the war has started and the Bolsheviks started killing Ukrainian activists, it now becomes possible for us, he says, to abandon the notion of federation with Russia and to truly embrace the notion of Ukrainian independence. So that is then the moment when the resistance is growing in the countryside under the slogans of Ukrainian autonomy, Ukrainian republic, Ukrainian identity. It's not strong enough to win because it really is just a part of the Russian civil war if you look at the geopolitical scheme, and the allies don't want to support the Ukrainian government at all for a variety of reasons. But that episode leaves the Ukrainian population with something really important, with the legacy of the open state, the Ukrainian People's Republic, and also with the legacy of reuniting the Ukrainian lands in the Austro-Hungarian and the Russian Empire, because there also a republic emerges, the Western Ukrainian People's Republic, and the two republics solemnly proclaim unification in January 1919. So actually, it's not Lenin. It really is Lenin who is reacting to the fact that there is a strength of Ukrainian feelings, and these feelings are connected to the peasant issue. He realizes that, to the issue of the land. So, and then in the fall of 1919, Lenin publishes a very interesting article. He finds the time to go into the statistical data on the elections to the All-Russian Constituent Assembly, as I always tell my students, the only free election ever held in Russia. And try to challenge that, actually. So incomplete, of course. There are returns from several Ukrainian provinces. So Lenin gets deep into statistical data. He loves this stuff, like his first major book is overwhelming in terms of statistical data, the development of capitalism in Russia. And he looks and says, it seems to confirm my assumptions, because it looks like the Ukrainian peasants overwhelmingly voted for the Ukrainian socialist revolutionaries and Ukrainian social democrats. And that means we really need to do something in Ukraine, namely to allow the official use of the Ukrainian language and to engage with the peasantry. So he's very clear about it. He's not actually creating anything new. He is responding to what has already happened. And of course, there is another very interesting, but rather kind of anecdotal, but still proof of what is in fact happening. In the 1920s, when the Ukrainian People's Republic is long defeated, Ukraine is under the Soviet rule, and the Bolsheviks are slowly going after political activists and peasant activists, there is an enormous nostalgia for the Ukrainian government, which, when it was in power, didn't receive all that much support. Nobody was particularly willing to fight. Everybody tired from the war, really. But after it was gone and the Bolsheviks actually established their real rule in Ukraine, which included terror, included confiscations, all kinds of things, then the peasants became enormously nostalgic. Was that the irony of Petlura, the Ukrainian military leader from the period, that he was now in exile, and perhaps he was more popular now in Ukraine than he was when he actually was the dictator. So going into the 1920s, there is significant peasant rebellions until about 1924, actually, and very often under the slogans of Ukrainian nationalism and the Ukrainian People's Republic, which the Bolsheviks are spending very long time to suppress. And that, of course, allows me to move in straight into the Stalin period and to say that, when we consider these factors and we realize that there was a real project which started spreading, didn't quite reach out to the peasantry, but enjoyed two moments of mobilization. One, when it was an anti-war mobilization in 1917, everybody wanted to leave the Russian army, and becoming a modern Ukrainian was one way of leaving the Russian army. But the Ukrainian government could not capitalize on it properly because it needed its own army. And the second moment of mobilization, which was wasted, was actually 1921 to 1923 approximately, maybe even 1924, when there were massive peasant rebellions under the slogans spontaneously going back to the period of the Ukrainian People's Republic. And that is a very, very lasting effect. Even during World War II in 1941, there are documented rumors in the countryside that Petlura will come back. But of course, Petlura is long dead. He was shot in Paris in 1926. But there is a memory somehow in the countryside that there is an alternative to the Bolsheviks that would involve the Ukrainian statehood. And that is, of course, what the Bolsheviks realize. And as is well known, the famines taking place around the Soviet Union during 1932-33 coalesced in Ukraine into a concerted attack at the same time on the Ukrainian intellectuals, primarily, by the way, village teachers, and an attack on the Ukrainian peasantry, where the measures taken against the peasantry were significantly harsher than elsewhere, and amounted to breaking the back of the nation. And, in order not to sound like a Ukrainian nationalist, I would have to actually tell you that this is what we find in Stalin's own correspondence and in secret decrees of the Central Committee that connect very clearly the presence of Ukrainization policies, the promotion of the Ukrainian schooling, first of all, and peasant insurgency. That the majority of Ukrainian intellectuals and political figures arrested during this period are charged not yet with being foreign spies, that is coming soon, just a few years later, but with actually preparing counter-revolutionary rebellions in the countryside. And the investigators are actually, that is a long-standing trend in Ukraine, beginning in the early 1920s even. Every intellectual investigated by the GPU, later NKVD, they tried to connect him to the to the plans of organizing a peasant counter-revolutionary insurgency. The hardest hit group of Ukrainian intellectuals during the early 1930s, village teachers, who are assumed to be not only nationalistic, but connected to the peasantry and Cossettism, particularly dangerous. And so when you consider these two developments, the attack on the Ukrainian peasantry, all these blacklisted villages, all these cordons preventing the peasants leaving the village or crossing the Russian border, then together with Stalin's statements about his fear to lose Ukraine in connection also with potential Polish infiltration, but no doubt also because of the Ukrainian peasantry, then it becomes fairly clear that this is really the last act of the Ukrainian revolution. But the revolution in Ukraine did not end in 1920, but it actually ended in 1933, when the genocidal famine destroyed the countryside, destroyed the power of the peasantry. Of course, famine is a blunt instrument, right? So peasants died who were Jewish, peasants died who were Russian, Germans died as well. Also, they received parcels from Germany. At least there were other options for him, but it's a blunt instrument, right? But it was accompanied by a very impressive attack, including show trial. Already in 1930, a major show trial in Ukraine held at the Opera House in the capital of Ukraine, of Ukrainian intellectuals, with special emphasis on teachers, actually, showing that they were counter-revolutionary and wanted to spread the agenda from 1917, 1918. So that's the connection there, that Stalin takes a long time to settle his account with the Ukrainian revolution, but he finally does. And he then creates something else. What he creates, as I'm going to argue in one of subsequent books, is actually a safe ethnographic version of Ukrainian culture. And the markers of that are fairly symbolic in themselves. The Soviet authorities construct monuments to major Ukrainian writers. Taras Shevchenko receives in 2 years, three major monuments in Ukraine, all of them still standing. And at the same time, monuments to Russian writers are open all around Ukraine. Some of them are now being removed actually this week as we speak. And at the same time, the Ukrainian writers are recruited for major positions in the government. Why would you do that? Why would you want to have the head of your parliament and the Minister of Education and the Deputy Premier, and the list goes on and on and on, as major writers? They know nothing about government, but that's precisely the indication of what kind of Ukraine Stalin is building. They represent the Ukrainian people because they are writers. They can legitimately speak Ukrainian in most Ukrainian cities at the time. If you actually speak Ukrainian, well, you become suspicious. That really slowly develops from the late 1930s and continues throughout the entire post-war period. And this notion of a safe ethnographic nation, the nation of singing and dancing, it's actually also very telling that still existing major Ukrainian choir companies and the dancing ensemble, both created under Stalin, 1937, 1943. So it really becomes a picture of creating a canon of Ukrainian culture, which can exist. And because these people are the only Ukrainians, they also have to be in the government, because we cannot possibly have Ukrainian politicians at all. So this version then is accompanied, of course, by the propaganda of the great friendship among the nations of the Soviet Union and the leading role of the Russian nation as well. And after World War II, the notion of reunification is rehabilitated too. So here what we see is, of course, that it is already under Stalin, who technically recognizes Ukrainians as a separate ethnic group, but he makes them a very particular ethnic group. The notion of the three parts of the great Russian nation is being rehabilitated very clearly. And of course, by comparing Ukraine with Belarus, you would immediately realize that something is missing in Ukraine. Something is wrong. And that actually is the absence of a strong assimilatory drive under Stalin already, which is present in Belarus, but not in Ukraine. So why would that happen? Turns out that when in September 1939, the Soviet Union annexes Eastern Poland and divides it into the Ukrainian and Belarusian parts and attaches them to the existing Ukrainian and Belarusian republics, there is no concern about nationalist resistance in Belarus. But there is a concern about nationalist resistance in Ukraine. And lo and behold, it's actually connected to the peasants again. So, because the peasants support the nationalistic resistance, and they support it also because of the very same reason they don't want to collectivize agriculture. It really takes enormous effort in 1946-47 to collectivize agriculture. And these actually become really the worst years of nationalistic insurgency in Western Ukraine. So one of the solutions taken by the Soviet authorities is in fact to temporarily suspend the assimilation in Western Ukraine. Because at that point, that part of the country is really governed by the military. Lviv is primarily a Russian-speaking city in the late 1940s. Even tram lines and tram stops are spelled in Russian rather than in Ukrainian. Most of the teaching is done in Russian. But then the authorities at one point realize that this actually fuels their resistance too. So they're back to square one. They're back to Lenin's dilemma from 1919. So not only there is a peasant resistance to collectivized agriculture, but it is connected to this protest against assimilation and against treating the Ukrainian language in a certain way. And they make a decision which they don't make in Belarus, namely to allow education and publication of newspapers and television programs eventually in Ukrainian. This is done in order to prevent the buildup of nationalist resistance. But this is not done in Belarus. And so as the assimilation then continues unabated in Belarus, which ironically is going to make it Europe's last dictatorship until, of course, Russia itself became a second dictatorship. But not in Ukraine, interestingly enough, because they couldn't push this agenda. They actually started pushing it very late, already under Khrushchev in the late 1950s, and was also impossible because that was the moment of recruitment, the new generation, baby boomers, going through schools, joining universities, cities develop. These people come from countryside, and they assume that education in Ukrainian is the right. And so the Ukrainian authorities actually apply two different cultural policies in central and eastern provinces and in the West. They allow the existence in the West of a stronger Ukrainian identity. And that proves to be an important factor in the 1960s when Ukrainian dissidents come along. For them, actually going to the West and working there, or better yet, marrying there, becomes a rite of passage because there is the real Ukraine. And then they come back to the central Ukraine or stay in the West, but using the language of Leninism, they argue that there is a rite of the Ukrainian ethnic nation. And so in this way, the Ukrainian identity and the Ukrainian agenda survives into the late Soviet period. Except, of course, in the Crimea. Right. And on the issue of the Crimea, on which I get lots of questions during various talks, It is, of course, important to understand that the Crimean autonomy was not originally created for the Russians at all. When it was created, Crimea was divided nearly equally among the three groups, the Crimean Tatars, Russians, and Ukrainians in 1921. It also took the Bolsheviks a long time to decide what to do with the Crimea. It's only 1921 that they finally agree that it is going to be separated from the Taurida province, and it's going to be its own entity. And of course, when discussing the borders during the period 1914 and beyond, the sides in the Russian-Ukrainian negotiations, and eventually in negotiations with Germans as well, were relying on ethnographic maps of the Russian imperial provinces. And Crimea was part of the Taurida province, and up north in the steppes, which were essential, by the way, for the Crimean economy. This is the whole reason why, very late in the Civil War, under Wrangel, the whites cannot stay bottlenecked there in the Crimea. They actually have, and they try twice, to go into the up north, into the steppes, because they cannot survive in Crimea. And that's actually a major factor in why they were defeated, too. So the separation of the Crimea is in itself a very interesting act of Soviet power, which was, as far as we can determine, aimed at the global South, at sending a signal that a Muslim culture, an Islamic Crimean Tatar culture, is possible in the Soviet Union. And of course, that very fact that ethnic Russians become a majority happens over the course of three nights in May 1944, when Stalin organizes deportation of the Crimean Tatars in their entirety, which of course scholars today also call a genocidal deportation because of the rate of death on the road and during the first year after being dumped in Central Asia. So with that exception, and of course this exception is also very interesting to think through, why did Khrushchev want to make Crimea part of Ukraine other than being a bit of a Stalinist imperialist? In working with the documents of the Ukrainian Central Committee during the late war period, I realized that he had a file prepared on the Crimea in 1944 with a complete economic and statistical profile on the peninsula. So he probably was thinking already of one day incorporating it. But of course, the answer, which was probably obvious to Khrushchev, was not limited to, you know, vacation spot and the economic rationality. It was also making a more balanced Ukraine to counteract that national identity in the West. And that's precisely the legacy he left for the late Soviet period and the legacy he left for independent Ukraine, because it ended up having a region populated by the majority ethnic Russians, Crimea, and the Ukrainians' population in Crimea, about 24% in 2001, was politically mobilized as Russians, not as Ukrainians at all. But they basically sided with ethnic Russians in this Soviet-style mobilization against the returning Crimean Tatars, against the Ukrainian language, interestingly enough. And the other region where Ukrainians do constitute, or did actually constitute, the majority was the Donbas in the southeast. But there, the Russian speakers were in majority as well. So during the census time, people would say, "We are Ukrainians. What is your language?" They would argue, "Russian." And there is the reason, a good reason, of course, it's enormous turnover of labor, the difficulties the Soviet authorities were experiencing when securing the labor for the Donbas during the post-war period, right after the war, late 1940s, early 50s, they actually recruit in Western Ukraine for the Donbas, which has profound implications, because then they have to start Ukrainian newspapers being published in the Donbas to accommodate that particular audience. But also the story of the Donbas is a story of the recruitment that never lasts, because people try to evade hard work in the mines. And the Soviet image of a miner is, in fact, an answer to this very real dilemma of securing a labor force for the region. So there is a constant turnover there, and the turnover which shapes the region culturally in a certain way. But then a significant number of Ukrainian dissidents and poets, actually perhaps the most famous Ukrainian dissident poet, Vasil Stus, perhaps the most famous Ukrainian dissident, Ivan Zuba, came actually from the Donbas. So that is the legacy, and I'm going to wrap up very soon. This is the legacy of the Russian-Ukrainian relations and Ukrainian identity, which was left for the independence period. And it was left, of course, for the period of rethinking the Soviet experience. And what Mr. Putin now does is, in fact, rethinking the Soviet imperial, the Soviet period in a very imperial way, because he really likes to go back to the Russian Empire more than to the Soviet Union. But if you do that, then the only way of explaining the existence of the Ukrainian group is, in fact, to blame it on the authorities after the collapse of the Russian Empire, because the Russian Empire denied its existence. And therefore, this is the way in which Lenin becomes responsible for it. And therefore, we have a wonderful dilemma for those of us studying historical memory and monuments in the fact that the Russian army and the pro-Russian authorities in occupied areas of Ukraine are restoring Lenin monuments, whereas Mr. Putin claims that Lenin was really bad and in fact responsible for building Ukraine, and his hero is really General Denikin on the white side, but somehow it suits his purposes to start restoring Lenin monuments in Ukraine because, well, and here becomes a topic for another lecture I cannot give today, but basically because Lenin is imagined very differently in Ukraine. It is imagined as a symbol of unity with Russia and the good Soviet past. So a very delicate balancing act needs to be performed here in order to keep the Russian and Ukrainian imaginations of Lenin completely separate. And then, of course, there are historians in the West who can ask unpleasant questions about it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Serhy. That was indeed a marvelous tour through Ukrainian history. And as you said at the beginning, so much more than one gets in one's newsfeed. That's for sure. We'll have to have you back to talk about the place of Lenin in this whole conversation. I want to pass over to folks in the audience for questions. If you have a question, can you do as our friend David Hoffman has done and just kind of click the raise hand button at the bottom? If you go to reactions and click on that, there's a raise hand option. And so if you're interested in asking a question, do that. And we'll work our way through in order of how they come up. So David, I'll pass over to you.
Thanks, Nick. And thanks, Serhy, for a very interesting talk. I wondered if you could say a little more about the Stalin era. You were talking about how Stalin created a sort of safe version of Ukrainian culture. And of course, this sort of fit with the broader Soviet or Stalinist nationality policy of national informed socialist in content. So in other words, the national inform is the folk dance troops. They don't pose any political danger because they don't have any sense of, you know, national separatism. And I was wondering if you could say a little more about policy in Ukraine. Was this basically the same as in other Soviet republics, or what were the unique features of this effort to create a sort of safe ethnographic nation of Ukraine within, you know, the Soviet Union?
Well, there was actually one at least unique feature, and that was that any Ukrainian identity, even a safe ethnographic one, could be seen as a challenge to the Russian identity itself, because the Russian identity was not being developed, as is the argument of David Brandenberger and others in the field, that the Soviet Union never, the Soviet Union never really asked the Russians to come to terms with their imperial past. And the short period during the 1920s clearly was not enough. And the rhetoric around it was only applicable in the other republics, not Russia itself. So that is a bit of an issue. And also because Ukrainians did live in very significant numbers in the Russian Federation. So one Stalin's decree in 1932 that marks the start of this genocidal campaign against intellectuals, teachers, and at the same time against the peasants was in fact about halting the Ukrainization policies in the Russian Federation. And that in itself was very significant because prior to that, there were millions of Ukrainians living there. And of course, the fact that they had the right to be educated in Ukrainian undermined the Russian Federation's vision of itself. So it's actually very logical for Stalin to stop this first, even before, like way before these policies are gradually phased out in Ukraine. They have to be stopped in Russia because they are a threat to Russia. So the it can be argued, and I'm sure it probably was, that the Stalinist Russian identity is very much the same. It is a safe and ethnographic mode until, of course, we arrive at the point of the Russian people as the guiding force. And then Stalin's infamous toast at the end of World War II to the Russian people. So the Russians don't actually get too much there. So they are not all of them are beneficiaries. In fact, the majority are not beneficiaries of Stalinist policy. But I think the Ukrainian example actually indicates the danger that the Russian identity itself can hold for Stalinism as well. So that the entire ethnic principle is dangerous. And from my point of view, this indicates the moment of going back to the tsarist project, of banning the Ukrainian education, but not promoting education in Russia either. Kind of trying to present the ambivalence, the ambiguity, which is present in the notions of the Communist Party's leadership. Right? So it's always about the Communist Party. You can talk a little bit about the Russian people, but not too much. So it's a very, very, very interesting imperial project that they are running, I think. Ukraine is special and the Baltic republics are special because they have this enormous nationalistic resistance. And they have these territories incorporated only during World War II. And a decision is taken, a very conscious decision to actually give them more leeway. So in a way, only a part of Ukraine ends up being seen as far, whatever, Europe's Far East, as I think Roman Sporluk called it. Like the place where everybody is watching Polish television, for instance, right? There are plenty of cross-border contacts. And it is just inescapable that this part will be different, but it cannot be isolated from Ukraine itself. So then the entire Ukrainian identity is contaminated. And that's the argument I'm trying to connect with a well-known statement by Khrushchev after Stalin's death, that Stalin had wanted to deport all of Ukrainians, but there were too many of them and there was no place to put them to. But I think Khrushchev didn't specify that Stalin probably meant Western Ukrainians. So that's what probably was the intention, because that particular, and then it becomes connected to Jeff Weidlinger's notion of, you know, Jews becoming a diaspora nationality. And I told him at one conference that, you know, Jeff, you are completely right. Now, the Jews now have a state outside of the Soviet Union, therefore all of them are contaminated in some way. But what happened to Ukraine is actually very similar. A part of Ukraine comes from another state and contaminates the entire nation. And therefore that creates a very specific situation for Stalin and for his successors. And of course, then the story of the Soviet collapse as seen from Ukraine begins in 1988 with the first unauthorized mass rally in Lviv to support the rights of the Ukrainian language. So the precise point, you can almost say, well, that's where the Tsarist policy stopped and the revolution started in 1917. This is also the point where Stalinism stopped and whatever, and the 60s took over. It is expressed in the categories of ethnic politics, but it actually is more than that. And this is what we see in present day revolutions in Ukraine too. Like, people acknowledge that the Ukrainian language is very important, but then you ask, do you actually speak Ukrainian at home? No, but Ukrainian language is important as a symbol of democracy, nation, Europe, and everything. So there is a connection there. I'm still working out the details about exactly how they connect, but they do, in my opinion. Sorry for taking too long to answer.
No, thank you so much. Matthew, and I hope I pronounced your last name correctly, Matthew Huller, you have a question?
Yes, no, you pronounced it close enough. Thanks. My question is about the role of historians. I'm currently reading Serhy Plokhy's On Making Imperial Russia, which talks about the role of historian as nation builder in the first half of the 20th century. And we have these famous historians, Hrushevsky, Lipinsky, Doroshenko, et cetera. And so my question is, at the end of the short 20th century, after 1991, how do historians and historical memory play a role in unmaking Soviet memory systems and Soviet legacy and help to build a distinct Ukrainian national identity after 1991? Thank you.
This is a great question. It would require two hours for me to answer. I've just approved the proofs of the book on that very topic. Maybe I can share a screen and find the... Anyway, so the book is coming from Ibidem Press and distributed by Columbia in the United States, and it's called Writing the Nation, the Ukrainian Historical Profession in Independent Ukraine and the Diaspora. So I just wrote the entire book on this issue. So I can try to cover it in 1 minute. And essentially, the big point is this. A, it was not a straightforward process at all. The Soviet legacies were important for decades, and they remain important. The dogmatic approach to kind of, you must have quotations from the classics, now the Ukrainian classics. And it's taken a while for the entire profession to transition, but the most recent developments in education and the openness of universities in Europe to Ukrainian historians, they basically only accelerate the trend of transitioning to Western methodology, which is happening. Second, the role of a diaspora turns out to be more ambivalent than I would normally assume. But the diaspora is not just the holder of nationalistic mythology, which is then transferred solemnly to Ukraine. Because by the 1990s, the Ukrainian diaspora has plenty of professional historians who grew up in the West, do research very sophisticated methodologically, conceptually, but the main subject for them still remains the Ukrainian nation. So what is transferred is not or not just nationalist mythology, but in fact, a kind of the constructivist view of what modern nation is. There is a ton of that. Memory is a huge topic. Memory is a huge topic. And of course, Ukraine is involved in a memory war with Russia, which sort of determines some of the Ukrainian responses, which I may not particularly like, but I realize that we need to contextualize them because they passed this legislation because the previous year Russia passed that legislation. So they're basically answering each other. And this is also changing because the recent Ukrainian revolution and the war are producing a very diverse group of new national heroes. Like the symbols of the revolution, they are not even ethnic Ukrainians. The person who started the revolution, like the first prominent victim and such, the soldiers as well. So it actually emphasizes the notion of a civil society as a foundation of new Ukraine. And that asks for a different methodology, different conceptualization of what the Ukrainian nation is. This is as far as I can go within 1 minute. As I said, the book will be released in December, called Writing the Nation.
Marvelous. Well, I look forward to that book coming out. We have about 5 minutes and a couple of questions. And so maybe what we'll do is we'll take a question from Theodora and from Lydia, and then we'll do both questions, and then you can mix and match from what they say. So Theodora, if you want to jump in.
Thank you so much for this brilliant overview. I actually want to continue this conversation about the construction, the modernist construction constructionist view of the nation that you, you know, explained so clearly here. I'm a scholar of the modern Balkans, and I was, it makes sense to me that there's this moment of crystallization of the Ukrainian nation during World War One, when these different parts, different lands come together in contact, and people start discovering that they can be speaking to other people from across a border that now is disappearing. Have you discovered a good, effective way to talk to lay publics about this phenomenon of sudden nationhood, right? Something that we know as scholars exists in a variety of situations, but people want antiquity. People want to go back, you know, as far back as possible. If you have time, I would love you to also talk to us what exactly are the Russian archaeologists looking for in Northwestern, wherever they're digging. I mean, they're obviously looking for something there. But my question is mainly, you know, how do you explain this to lay people who actually want antiquity? And then how do you counter, you know, because you can't just go and say, okay, Mr. Putin, but how about the modern Russian nation? This is what you said. I understand where you're coming from, but you're not winning any friends with this argument either. So how do we talk to people and explain that to them? Thank you.
That's great. Thank you, Theodora. Lydia, do you want to jump in with a question? And then Serhy can delve into it all.
Yes, thank you so much. Absolutely fascinating talk. My question is, so would you characterize the late 80s, early 90s as a decolonization regarding Ukraine? And sort of connected to that, what do you make of sort of current punditry suddenly talking about decolonization related to the end of the Soviet Union right now in a way that no one was until the last couple of years?
All right, 5 minutes, Serhy.
Thank you.
That was several books, I think.
Wonderful but difficult questions. But I tend to be actually very pragmatic answering Theodora's question. I just basically use as a starting point the election results in Ukraine in recent decades. And if you need to persuade someone and say, well, you see, 72% voted for this. And for decades, the entire Southeast was voting for that. And then tell them, well, there must be a historical background to that. If we have this complexity and hybridity in the present, it certainly means that not every ethnic Ukrainian is a great patriot now. So that would sort of suggest that there were not born Ukrainian patriots back then. And then, I'm sorry, I'm guilty of bringing the empire back, saying, well, that's because, you know, there's the imperial alternative. And when I say this, I don't feel bad about myself as a historian, because there is really the option of becoming a Russian. And of course, the speaker of the Russian parliament, that is actually a woman from Ukraine, and there are plenty of Russian ministers and generals who are from Ukraine. So making that point, I usually go through the present period saying, hey, you see, that's what was happening under the Soviet rule during the post-war period. Do we have any reason to believe that it was different under the Tsarist rule? Of course, no. And that kind of opens some windows. There's a limit to how far you can get, because some people would want antiquity before Christ and going to the pyramids and whatever. Which I explain by actually bringing in the post-colonial angle, by this engagement with empire and trying to remove any roots of the empire from even the most ancient narratives, with all the consequences that that entails. And so, yes, so my primary device for that is, in fact, saying, but are you happy with the elections of 2019? And people say, oh no, it was a terrible mistake. Like 72% of the population did not understand what it means to be a true Ukrainian. Well, that was the same in the 19th century. And that was the same in the 18th century. And the list goes on. So that sort of works, sort of. There's a limit to how far it could take you. The decolonization, I was actually one of the people promoting that concept and getting lots of flack for it, because I was arguing that decommunization was problematic because the Ukrainian legislation of 2015 basically banned all the symbols and figures connected to the Bolshevik and Soviet rule, except for those who made a contribution to Ukrainian culture. And of course, my argument was, but you know what? Putin is not a member of the Politburo of the Central Committee. He really is not a general secretary of the Communist Party, and he even doesn't like the Communist Party to start with. And he hates Lenin, as he explicitly said many times. And in fact, Putin used the term decommunization himself, threatening to decommunize Ukraine, by which he means basically to take away the territories that were brought into the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic during the Soviet rule. But that was, of course, the answer to the notion of a united Ukraine which pre-existed the Soviet rule. No, but, and so I was trying always, I was actually educated in Australia to some degree in the early 1990s, studying with a literary scholar and doing a lot of reading on post-colonial studies, which to me explained a lot in Ukrainian intellectuals' behavior after the Soviet rule. Plenty of things that they share with colonial intellectuals after the empire withdrew, so in the process of trying to construct the oven version of the past and creating new hierarchies and doing things and reversing cultural hierarchies. So I've always propagated that as much as I could in interviews and such. Now, and decolonization is in this way, actually is a positive vehicle because it forces people to reevaluate the Soviet experience, because the easiest way prior to that was to say that, well, the entire Soviet period was occupation. That's it. So we were occupied, all right? But of course that would lead us to the fact of Ukraine constantly being occupied by some power and there never being real Ukraine as such, right? So, and of course, if we are forced to look and the reservation about decolonization is, of course, that needs to come complete with the evaluation of the role Ukrainians, ethnic Ukrainians played in these imperial projects. And I'm really grateful for recent research at Cambridge. I actually went in September there for a conference on the Ukrainian famine. And there's a brilliant younger scholar from Ukraine working in the UK who did research on the perpetrators of the Ukrainian famine in the countryside. And of course, the majority are ethnic Ukrainians. So here we are, like the greatest national tragedy, the genocide organized perhaps by Stalin. But if you want to be consistent and you want to trace what is going on there, these are the ethnic Ukrainians. And so in a way, I like decolonization because it opens up access to this entire apparatus of post-colonial studies, which is really good for the interpretations of culture. The objections to that in Ukraine, and the objections are also a funny post-colonial nature, arguing that Ukraine was never a colony. And I would say, so you're arguing it was actually part of Russia. So it was not the Russian colony. You're saying it was, okay, Putin is smiling at you, right? So it forces people to think through what it means exactly when you blame either communism for everything or the colonial past for everything, right? And the notion of colonialism is not acceptable to some nationalists for the suggestion of the inequality and imperial hierarchy present in it. They want to be equal to Russians in that. And I like the kind of windows it opens. Not all of them are for the mass audience, but some are fairly interesting.
Wonderful. Well, Serhy, thank you so very, very much for joining us today for this brilliant talk and for your insights, particularly in terms of thinking about how we can talk about this history in a moment where nuance and complexity are being lost on the battlefield every day. And so thank you so very much. I hope everyone will join me in giving Serhy a virtual round of applause. Again, thank you so very much. We look forward to your books. We look forward to hearing you more. Otherwise, thank you all for joining today. We really appreciate it. We wish everybody, at least here in the United States, a happy Thanksgiving. We'll pick up our CHR series next semester with Adam Tooze. And otherwise, again, thank you and be well and goodbye. Enjoy the rest of your Friday.
Thank you so much for the invitation. It was a pleasure. I wish I could be the physical.
Next time.
But
next time we'll bring you out.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Serhy.
Okay. Thank you.